Fremont is actually a large delivery center as far as newborn infants. The number of births has been increasing every year, and we're up to about 1,750 births a year.
Gosh, now how does that compare, do you think, to hospitals in Sacramento?
In Sacramento, the only hospital that I'm positive has a larger delivery is Sutter Memorial. We actually have more deliveries than the medical center at Sacramento.
And for our area, in Yuba Sutter counties, the nursery is Fremont Hospital. There isn't another equipped nursery in this area, is there?
Correct. The Fremont Hospital Medical Center is the nursery, and the community's done a good job in combining the OB and the neonatal, the nursery facility, so we don't have duplication of resources.
This has allowed a lot of cost savings, I would think.
Right. It certainly has, and a lot more convenience, I think, for patients and physicians.
That's very true. In our film today, we saw some very impressive equipment at the nursery, and I know that patients don't pay for all this expensive equipment. How is this equipment brought to Fremont? Who pays for this?
Actually, we've had tremendous support from the community. There's one group that should especially be singled out. The Fremont Hospital Auxiliary has donated large amounts of money and equipment to enable us to maintain the most up-to-date equipment, some of which was seen today.
That's fantastic. So these people get out in the community and raise money and buy equipment?
Yes.
I guess they consult with the doctors to see what's needed, and then they work on a project to get that piece of equipment.
Right. They talk with us about what we need to maintain a good level of medical care for newborn infants, and then they're able to provide us with funds or the equipment.
It's very impressive. We have a really good community support here. It's nice to see that. Tell us about the new technique of measuring oxygen in the blood of newborns without using a needle. I know that my patients don't like needles, and I'm sure when they have babies at Fremont, they don't want their babies to be stuck with needles if that can be avoided. What does this new machine do?
It's called a transcutaneous oxygen monitor, and what it is, it's a special sensor which you just put on the skin of an infant, and it is actually able to read the level of oxygen in the arteries, the blood vessels, and tell us whether or not the child is getting enough, too much, or too little oxygen, and we can adjust the oxygen level on a continuous basis rather than having to do individual blood tests by drawing blood from the infant.
I guess in days before they had this ability to measure this, and people didn't realize the importance of maintaining a good oxygen level on newborns, especially premature babies.
Right. With premature infants, there's important as far as the eyes goes, there's important as far as too much oxygen over a long period of time can be bad for the lungs. And the other thing we've learned is various procedures, suctioning the infant, turning the infants, various manipulation of the infant can actually cause the oxygen level to fall down. And with this continuous ongoing monitoring of the oxygen level, we can see how each variation and technique affects the infant.
How would blood be taken from infants before this technique? Their veins are so small, I don't even know how you could get little needles in them.
Well, before the technique, there are a couple different methods. One is by actually pricking the heel of the infant with a needle and taking blood out that way. Another way, which is used in the sicker infants, is an umbilical artery catheter. It's a little plastic tube that is put through one of the blood vessels in the navel that connected the infant to the placenta.
The umbilical cord.
Right.
I see.
And by using that method, we can put a tiny tube into a major artery in the infant and be able to sample blood from him.
In our area, it seems that there are a lot of different types of physicians involved in the care of newborns and their mothers. In Marysville and Yuba City, what are the specialties that actually get involved in caring for newborns and their mothers?
I think family practice physicians and pediatricians are the two major groups of physicians who are involved in caring for infants. And then if the infants tend to be sicker and require a little more specialized care, the pediatricians will usually consult for the family practice physicians.
I see. So we're dealing then with many specialties working together. Seems very nice.
Correct.
Now, at what point is the obstetrician, the doctor that's delivered the baby, or the family practitioner that's delivered the baby, allow a pediatrician to take over and get involved in the care of that child?
Okay, if they examine the child briefly after the infant is born, and if they notice certain problems, breathing difficulties, birth defects, other things which may require a higher level of care, then they'll ask one of the pediatricians to consult on the infant and recommend further techniques to aid the infant.
I see. How is a baby given a pediatrician as their doctor? The mother comes in and they have an obstetrician, but they may not have thought about who's going to take care of the baby once it's born. How is that decided?
In many ways, if she gets to the hospital and she's not decided, depending on who the physician is who is delivering the baby, they will determine the pediatrician or the family practice physician who would care for the infant. In general, we encourage parents to think about who they would like to care for the infant before they get to the hospital so they can possibly meet with a physician and discuss plans for the infant and care after the birth.
So they really should think about this earlier and even talk to their friends, get recommendations that way.
Correct.
I would do that, I think. I understand now that fathers are taking a greater role in delivering babies at the hospital. I mean, not actually delivering them, but being in the delivery room. Well, tell us a little about that.
Right. Well, the fathers are taking the role of support persons in some of the natural childbirth techniques which are used. And these techniques are very helpful. They've shown that with a support person, mothers may require less medication during labor, and that means the infant will be born more alert and fewer problems with difficulty breathing. It also encourages making this a shared experience between the husband and the wife or the mother and the father. In cases where the mother can't be with the infant after delivery, such as cesarean sections, we also encourage the fathers coming into the nursery and being with the newborn infant and holding the infant, and that's been a very popular program.
Great. I'd like to change to a little more controversial an issue. It seems very frequently people are talking about circumcision of male children. Would you tell us exactly what is meant by circumcision and whether you believe that all male babies should have it?
Okay, circumcision is removal of the foreskin around the penis. It's been somewhat of a tradition following the birth of males in many societies, and in this country it's been followed fairly regularly by most groups. It's become controversial in that most physicians, the Academy of Pediatrics and the College of Obstetricians and Gynecologists, feel that routine circumcision of every male infant is no longer indicated, and good follow-up medical studies seem to suggest that non-circumcised infants do not have any more medical problems than circumcised infants do, if especially good hygiene is practiced after the child is older.
I see.
So in general, we are happy to perform circumcisions if parents want them. If parents are undecided, we're trying to present the pros and cons of circumcision versus non-circumcision, and in many cases we'll try and discourage them from having circumcision.
I see. With the fantastic modern technology that we have in hospitals, as we've seen today, that can save babies in an emergency situation, how do you feel about home delivery rather than having the baby born in the hospital?
Home delivery is an even more controversial subject. In general, as a physician, I tend to prefer delivery in the hospital. I think hospitals still have a responsibility to provide a more home-like setting for delivery, something that can be a little bit more family-oriented, less sterile, and potentially less complicated by medical technology and intervention. On the other hand, I tend to feel a mother and an infant has a greater chance of survival and a good outcome if there are any problems if they're born in the hospital.
I definitely will agree with you on that too. When is it necessary to transport a baby to a facility even more sophisticated than Fremont, such as Sacramento Medical Center at UC Davis, and how often are these transportations necessary?
It's interesting that you could ask that. Last night we had an infant that required intensive care in the newborn nursery and then was later transferred to Sacramento Medical Center. This child had hyaline membrane disease, which is the immature lung disease where the lungs are not fully developed, and the child was having difficulty breathing. The child required placement on a respirator to assist the child in breathing, and also required a catheter being placed in the umbilical cord to give fluids and monitor levels of oxygen. We also used the transcutaneous oxygen monitor to give us an ongoing monitor of the level of oxygen in the infant's blood. Because it looked like from his x-ray and his overall status that he would need to be on a respirator for at least a couple of days, we feel infants in that severe category should be transferred to the neonatal intensive care unit at the Sacramento Medical Center. They have an excellent facility and do an excellent job with the infant, and the infant is doing well down there, although still requiring the respirator.
Do they use ground transportation to get the infant there?
Yes. In this location, it's actually quicker to have the medical center send up a van and what they call their transport team of physicians and nurses who are able to transport the infant safely back to the medical center.
Well, thank you, Dr. Tomlinson, for joining me on the Medical Explorer tonight.
Oh, it's a pleasure being here.
Thanks. I'd like to invite you to write to me at the Marysville Medical Clinic with your suggestions for areas and people that you'd like to see on this program. The Medical Explorer is a public service program, and I really do want to hear from you with your comments and suggestions. Please write to me at the Marysville Medical Clinic, 800 3rd Street, Marysville 95901. In my next program, the Yuba Sutter Medical Explorer will take you into the office of a medical hypnotist. We'll watch him perform an actual hypnosis being done for medical reasons and learn more about the many ways that hypnotism can be used in medicine. I'm Dr. Robert Peppercorn, your medical explorer. Thank you for joining us tonight. Have a good evening.
This is Cable Channel 5, your local origination station serving the greater Hub area.